Good to be here.
Amen.
Amen. I thought I mustn't go very far from yesterday, as I was asked to talk about things that pertains or relates to family. Yesterday we were talking about forgiveness. So today I'm just going to continue on forgiveness and reconciliation. I will say together.
Yeah.
You know, how do we forgive and reconcile? Yesterday we have learned that if you don't forgive, or if you forgive, forgiveness is not for the person who have wronged you, but it's for your health as well. So when you forgive, you are releasing a slave of which the slave is you.
Yeah.
You know, so you are freeing yourself from, you know, the toxic things that come with unforgiveness. I was still together.
Yeah.
So today it's more like a part two, because I am more interested in unity. And unity begins in our homes. I will say it together. Everyone who is here is a fruit fallout from a family. So if we don't do things right in our own families, then we can't expect a miracle to make the church or the pews to be a sweet place.
Yeah.
So if our homes are not sweet, I will say it together, the pews in the church can never be sweet. So in other words, if we can't forgive at home, we can't, even by a miracle, if I'm in an African church, I say, even by an African science, I will stick together. We can't expect a miracle to help us overcome what we are failing to do at home. If you can't love your brother at home, you know, that you can see. I think the Bible does say that. You know, you say you love God whom you cannot see, but hate your brother whom you see. So if you can't love your brother, if you are not patient with your brother, it will be difficult when you come to church to be patient, you know, with the members of the church. I was still together.
Yeah.
You know, and then we look at the prayer of Jesus in John 17, verse 21, where he prays that they may all be one. Mm-hmm. I was still together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he did not pray, in as much as I believe in the health reform message, but he did not pray that we must be vegetarians. You know, he did not pray that we must be faithful tithe returners. I was still together. He did not pray that we must come early to church.
Yeah.
But in his last prayer, he saw it fit to say that they may be one.
Amen.
So in other words, the greatest challenge of Christ, it was not for us to become vegetarians. You know, the greatest challenge of Christ was not for us to become, you know, faithful tithe returners. I was still together. But as he was looking his disciples, he saw the greatest challenge was for them to be one.
Amen.
I was still together. So, and you know, and I also read what Alexander once said, that to err is what? Is human. But to forgive is divine.
Mm-hmm.
I was still together. So in other words, it's expected that we as human, we may falter, we may fail. But when you forgive, then we know that divinity is you know, is in control in your life. I was still together. You know, and I have a few things that I wanted to share today, how we can, you know, move forward. Have you ever noticed that we are very patient sometimes with our colleagues at work? This is the decoder of our message for today. If you miss this example, you will miss the message. You know, we are very patient with our colleagues at work, you know, particularly when you want to go and do some printing and you find that there's someone else in the printer. I was still together. You know, you're more willing to say, no, go ahead and print, I'll wait.
Okay.
I was still together.
Yeah.
But when you get home in the kitchen and you are thirsty, you know, you will make sure that the next person will understand how thirsty you are. I was still together. You don't understand, I'm just move, I want to get water. I was still together. But at work, no, you can print.
Okay.
And you can even ask, how many copies are you printing? 30 copies, I'll wait, I was still together. But when we get home, we are not patient with our loved ones.
Yeah.
The people that we live with in our very homes, I was still together.
Mm.
And even when we come to churches, well, sometimes we are not even patient with the people that Christ has died for. But when you get home to people who don't even care about Christ, you know, because you know that this will cost you your bread, you know, your job, you'll lose your job if you, you know, they may accuse you of other things. I was still together. So in other words, that's the, because in other words, if we need to be consistent, if you are patient with your colleagues, you need to be patient with your loved ones.
Yeah.
You know, there are people who, when they get home, even the dogs run away. I know. Because they it's just their demeanor or their character. I was still together. And sometimes you know, this is the biblical definition of being rich. Being rich is to be at peace with everything. You cannot say you are rich when you have 5 cars, but no one to ride with because you are hard-headed. Hello?
Hello.
You cannot be rich, and every time when you come home, you know, the kids are running away because they think a lion has arrived. Are we still together? And then you say you are rich. So to be rich is to have a good relationship with everyone. Are we still together? People must miss you when you are not around.
Yeah.
That's being rich spiritually. You know, and then the one thing that I wanted to add on yesterday's presentation is that unforgiveness somehow puts you in a parallel with God. Hello?
Yeah.
Remember the text in Matthew chapter 12, verses 31 and down. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, any sin that you commit, it can be forgiven. But the sin against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven. It's an unpardonable sin. I will sit together. And then when you read verses 32, it says, even when you speak something wrong against Christ, you will be forgiven. But if you speak anything wrong against the Holy Spirit, you will not be forgiven in this world and the world to come. So according to the Bible, there is only one sin that can what? Cannot be forgiven. I will sit together. So in other words, if we don't forgive other people, we are also equating ourselves to the Holy Spirit. You are not following. So in other words, we are saying you have committed an unpardonable sin that is equal as the sin of committing or that you commit to the Holy Spirit. I will see it together. So if there's anything that you say you cannot forgive, it's more like you are putting yourself on the throne and making yourself a small God. I was still together. Because there's only one sin according to. So in other words, you are editing the Bible to say, no, 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 Holy Spirit, you don't understand. That's not just the one sin which is unpardonable. Let me add another one.
Okay.
Hello? I was still together.
Oh, yeah.
So if you fail to forgive, you are equating yourself to the level of the what? Of the Holy Spirit. Have you not read what Oscar Pistorius' family said after Rivia's camp also, the family said after they killed their daughter. You remember? The mother and the father, they said, we forgive him. They are Christians. They said, even if we don't forgive Oscar, we can't redeem our daughter back. Yeah. I will sit together. So the best thing to do is to what? We forgive him. Whatever he has done, we forgive him. You know? And by doing that, they have released from self, from the slave, from being slave to what? You know, Oscar is down to them. I was still together. So when you don't forgive, you are saying, I know it's more like you have shares with the Holy Spirit, you know, that there are other sins which cannot be forgiven. And also, I read something that is interesting. They say, weak people revenge, strong people forgive, intelligent people ignore and insult. Hello? Should I repeat?
Yes.
Weak people do what?
Revenge.
Revenge. Remember yesterday we said forgive and forget, don't revenge and regret. They say weak people, they revenge, strong people forgive, but intelligent people, they ignore and insult. I will sit together. Let me give you another piece to think about. Have you ever met someone who says, you know, the way or whatever this person has done to me, I want to give them a piece of my mind.
Hey.
Hello? You know what that means?
Yeah.
When he says, I want to give them what? A piece. Don't go around giving people a piece of your mind. Because you'll be left with no brain. I will sit together.
Yes.
If you go around every time when you are angry, every time you want to give people a piece of your mind, you'll be left with what? Nothing. I will sit together. So, choose also to be intelligent and ignore an insult. You don't even subtract your bank balance. I will sit together. And this is what we are learning today. In fact, if I had time, we'll talk about Joseph. You remember in Genesis chapter 50, go and read that passage. They sold him, and Jesus, and Joseph says, you meant evil by selling me, but God meant good.
Amen.
You sold me, but God have sent me.
Amen.
I will sit together. So it is more like the mentality of turning lemons into what? Into lemonade. Whatever you meant bad about me, God turned it to what? To good. So in other words, that's the mentality that we should have as Christians in order for us to overcome any hurt, any bitterness or anything. He said, whatever you have meant to be evil, God have turned it to be good. Mm. I was still together.
Yeah.
You know, and I know there are many of us who also are afraid of gossip. You know, sometimes it's good for people to gossip about you. Amen. In fact, if someone gossips about you in the world, we know that they are afraid of you.
Okay.
Because if they were brave, they want to confront you. So it's a sign that they are what? Afraid of you. I'll sit together. You know, dangerous is a person who is not gossiped.
Okay.
Even Christ was gossiped.
Yeah.
Who are his parents? They say he was born of the Holy Spirit. They are lying. We know his father Joseph. I'll sit together. They gossiped Jesus as well. So what makes you think you are unique and special that you will not be gossiped? I will sit together. So expect these things to happen. And if you are wise, what? You ignore an insult. I will sit together. You know, and maybe in closing as well, I wanted to share that to have power and refuse to use power, it makes you to be powerful.
Mm-hmm.
I will sit together.
Yeah.
To have power, knowing that you can crush this thing, but refuse to use power, that makes you powerful. You remember Jesus on the cross?
Yeah.
I think we've heard the songs many times. It says he could have called 10,000 angels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He could have. He could have said, you know what, I'm sick and tired of this. He could have called planet Jupiter. What's the biggest planet? Jupiter.
Mm-hmm.
He could have called planet Jupiter to come and hit planet Earth from under him.
Mm-hmm.
And he would have remained sustained. I was still together. But by him refusing to use power, that made him to be powerful.
Mm.
I was still together. There are many of us who, because you are a man in the house, you say, I'm the man in this house, then you want to use power.
Mm.
I was still together. In fact, when you read the, I'm closing now, when you read, when God says, let them have dominion, he did not say, let them have dominion over human beings.
Mm.
He said, let them have dominions over the sea, the fishes of the sea, the wild beasts. I was still together. So in other words, if you want to exercise power, go to the wild beast. Hello? Go to the field. And you find lions there waiting for you. That's where we need to exercise what?
Power.
But some of us, because you are in this position, because you are maybe an elder or a pastor, then you want to enforce power over people. It's not what God has given us power to use it for.
Mm.
I was still together. So being powerful and refusing to use power, it makes you to be powerful.
Amen.
And by doing so, I like the closing is that, you know, after Joseph's brothers, they saw that Joseph's father has died. They said, this brother is going to hate us and revenge. And he says, no, fear not. You know, and that's where he said, you have meant evil, but God meant good.
Yeah.
And the next verse says, don't worry, I will nourish you.
Yeah.
I will sit together.
Mm.
I think you know the verse that says, if your enemy, you know, if you give enemy, you know, if your enemy is hungry, in another version it says, buy him lunch.
Okay.
That's the message by the way. Read the message by the way. It says, if your enemy is hungry, do what?
Buy him lunch.
So you don't conquer evil with evil. You conquer evil with what?
Good.
With good. The Bible says, if you conquer evil with evil, an eye for an eye makes the whole world blind. The Bible says, if you conquer evil with evil, you won't take evil out of your house.
Yeah.
For the married, but I will talk about this next time. If you are married as well, you don't conquer evil with evil. I will sit together. If maybe your husband didn't do you well, prepare him the best breakfast. I will sit together.
Yeah.
That's how you conquer evil with evil. You don't say, today, I will starve you. I will act like my hand is broken, I won't cook it. By doing so, you will perpetuate the evil in the house. I will sit together. So, after all, let us become like Joseph. Joseph had power, you know, to sabotage and do away or maybe revenge to his brothers. But he says, don't worry, I will nourish you. I will sit together.
Yeah.
Don't worry, I will not. Even David the king, he says, is there anyone left in the house of Saul that I will show him kindness for the sake of Jonathan? He had power to go and destroy the whole house of Saul. I will sit together.
Mm-hmm.
But by him refusing to use power, he remained powerful. And that is what I wanted to challenge us today. That you may have power, you know, to destroy other people, but by refusing to use that power, heaven sees you as powerful.
Amen.
May the good God bless you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.